This is a session not typical to the Battle of Ideas. Normally there's panel debates with heady discussion and argument and feistiness. That may come up, but in general, this is in conversation, taking a look at the life and legacy of Zaha Hadid's work. Zaha Hadid, who's even known by one of the names, you don't have to use both, like Bardot or Monroe. These things work for Zaha. Even my mother knew who Zaha Hadid was. She has a hard job knowing who I am when I come home. But actually, Zaha Hadid splits opinion. It is fair to say that, in my opinion, there was a lot of, in some ways, sycophantic testimonial when Zaha died by people who subsequently had been critical of her work. So there's a strange thing for me, but I don't know whether Patrick agrees with me on this. But in this discussion, we want to just take a look at some of the work, some of the controversies, and some of the ambitions that were within her organization that Patrick now is director of. Patrick Schumacher, you all know, has been known to talk ad nauseum about subjects using words that nobody's ever heard of. But I have briefed him to simplify it a little bit for me and keep the answers quite short, because we want to try and do maybe half an hour presentation, half an hour for you to give your views, comments, and observations. Yes? You are allowed to be critical. I know that Zaha is dead and you're meant to respect that, but actually you are allowed to be a little bit critical if you so are so minded. So what I'm gonna do is just take a few issues and see what Patrick's reflections on them are. The first one, I suppose, just looking at this photograph, which is a really beautiful photograph of Zaha, is that she never really made great play, as I understand it, of being a woman. And at the moment, we have this major campaigns everywhere you turn on women in architecture, on equal rights, on getting more women involved in architecture. So I just wanted to get your view on, you know, what she made of that type of discussion and what her views on the subject were, if you could reflect on it.
Well, she certainly resented to be called one of the great women architects or the greatest women architect in the field. She took that as a slight, and she that kind of qualification is truly not, I think, to the point, because she, irrespective of her gender, obviously, she made a big impact and was one of the great innovators and figures in the field. And so she resented that, always being categorized. She resented also this search for sources in her work, the particular originality and repertoire she developed and style she developed. There was this attempt to find sources in her femininity but also sources in her cultural background, in her Arabic upbringing and so on. So she wasn't into that. And I think she was right to resist both of these attempts to explain her or locate her in the field. She did sometimes collaborate with the notion that architecture is more of a male-dominated profession, and that maybe was more the case when she started. So reflecting on how she made her path, that was perhaps more difficult. And I think there was a truth in this also, when you started being your own author and business representative and leader in the world of developers and clients, that was slightly tougher stance. Also, she sometimes mentioned she's in part of the networking circles, which often distribute jobs in clubs and similar conditions. So she wasn't part of that. And she reflected and admitted that this was maybe not so easy. But I think she also recognized that this is no longer true, and that these difficulties have been overcome or disappearing, and have been disappearing for quite a while. So I think that was her position. She didn't. She was critical of. And resisting to talk too much about this topic, to be honest.
Okay, stop talking then.
Yeah.
But what we're going to do is just flag up some issues, right? So we're going to try and go through maybe four or five or six topics give you a flavour of Zaha and what Patrick also thinks, so you can then come back on it. Yes, so we'll
can
lay
I tell
that
you
rest.
What I think about this?
No. You're channeling Zaha's spirit. No, so look, we're going to go through a couple of pictures. We're going to start with the Vitra, which I kind of think is probably the origins of her work, 1981, her first public commission. And in some ways, as we say, like she's loved or hated, there's something about this building that has been criticized as either not working very well, or people didn't like to use it, or the harshness of the structure. How do you see it from your own point of view, but also from the practices point of view?
Yes, there's been not only with this building, with a few other buildings like Maxi, there's been the presumption or suspicion that this is an approach to architecture which is disrespectful of practicalities, the initial purposes for these buildings, and just treats these buildings as excuses to develop an artistic venture and spectacle. And I think that's something she resented, that's something we resent, I resent. But one has to add one qualification to this. This building in particular, the first building, let's say, of Zaha Hadid architects and Zaha Hadid of note, was of course an opportunity to create a manifesto statement about new possibilities in architecture, a new language of architecture. So it is pointing beyond itself, and the meaning and purpose and power of this building isn't that it is the best fire station in the world. It's a fire station for a factory, so it's something rather unimportant and secondary as a program, but it became an important moment in the history of architecture, I think, for us, and for is perceived like this, similar to maybe the Rietveld House or Haus Schröder of Gerhard Rietveld, is not being judged by the fact that it is perfect family domicile for the Schröder family. But at the same time, I would argue that the way we developed this project as a manifesto project was also trying to demonstrate that this new language of architecture is inherently interested in working with program, with function, with the functional process of this and any other building, but particular. So there are particular elements and aspects which I could start talking about in detail. But the way the you can see in the drawings, the fire trucks pushed under that roof, with the way the lines of the fire trucks drive through that, the way that was a very, very large open span, the way the ancillary functions connect into it and indicate straight lines of movement and exits of the firemen, etc. So there is the particular figure was developed out of contextual and programmatic logics, which then translated with new degrees of freedom to represent and articulate these logics. So that's why it was hurting us, and we wouldn't admit that we just abused the program to make an architectural statement. For us, architectural statements are always about, and the manifesto is also including new ways of recognizing and working with program and purposes. So that's why we resented that, and it was working perfectly well as a fire station. And the fact that it was later on closed, which was often cited against us, had nothing to do with the particulars of this building. It had to do with the factory finding it more economical to let the municipal fire station service their factory rather than having their own trucks and staff maintained. So this was the point.
Okay, yeah. Just before, can I have a show of hands? Who are architects or want to be architects or designers who really think they're architects? Hands up, architects. Hands up, non-architects who couldn't care less but just interested. Okay, good. Right, now we have a picture. Right, so that curtails our language a little bit. Yes. Let me just, since you mentioned the idea of manifesto and all the rest of it, this is a relief model of the same building, and then we come on to the Malevich stuff. So basically, Zaha wrote very widely, talked widely, gave lots of lectures about this as being one of the fundamental influences of her design ideas. I know that there were some criticisms, or you had some arguments about some of these things. So, but can you just, again, just talk about this kind of constructivist, suprematist school of the 1920s in Russia, and why it was so influential, why it was so important to you as a practice?
I think the context of Zaha's career is she started as a student in the early 70s and finished in the late 70s, and then started her personal career in 1980. But already had made a mark as a student based on retrieving some of the power and dynamism of suprematism. This was the period when modernism was challenged and in crisis, and there was a search for new ways forward, and the first anti-modernist way forward out of that perceived crisis was postmodernism, was going back into the history of motifs and styles and make architecture less monotonous and make it speak and allow it to be diversified by dipping into history, and you create a kind of neo-historicism. And so that was the immediate context. And there was a movement against that, so it's a kind of anti-postmodernist movement, but at the same time accepting that the kind of monotony and sterility then perceived of mid-20th century modernism wasn't the way forward. So it was a look for having new and fresh and non-retrograde ways of picking up the idea of diversifying and enriching and making more complex architectural urban settings, and also re-inhabiting historic centers, but not with historical citations, but with new elements which allowed, for instance, in complex sites to have multiple angles come together, where you build up complexity by overlapping spaces and interpenetrating maybe old and new or various spaces. So this was become a resource. Those avant-garde of the early 20th century, they have been in a similar position, trying to find new ways for a new kind of society, for the industrial society after the First World War. And they're proliferating and creating so many informal experiments, some of which were picked up and developed throughout the century. But there was an excess of experiments through abstract art, which then could be dipped in again. And that was the initial source of what then became deconstructivism. But it very soon also went beyond that and developed out of this initial inspiration. It wasn't a retrograde or retro approach. It was just an inspiration to do something much more forward-looking. And it was always consciously not a retro approach, but an inspiration to find certain features in suprematist painting and sculpture rather than in the architecture of the 1920s. The architecture of the 1920s was also inspired by abstract art, but had a much more restrained vocabulary based on serial repetition, on maintenance of orthogonality, etc. So that was the meaning, I think, of that going into the avant-garde again.
Okay, you said orthogonality, so we have to move on. Right. It was very nice actually seeing you take a look at the Malevich for the last 5 minutes. I don't think many people have looked at that black square for such a long time. I also put this picture up. This is the Cardiff Bay Opera House, which was supposed to be the first commission in the UK. I put it up because this is pre-computer. This is BC, isn't it? Before computers. and it's such a horrible graphic that I thought I'd show it. But this
it
is
terrible.
This is,
yeah.
This
is the Hearts and Minds campaign for the project.
Oh, yeah. I put some new images in there of it. And This is my sketches. So in terms of the Cardiff Bay Opera House, how was that taken in the practice? I mean, the fact that, you know, getting the competition and then having it rejected, and I know there were some terrible headlines in South Wales newspapers. I hope my accent is not coming out here. I wasn't responsible. But there were many, many terrible accusations within the press in the time of this. So how was that taken as a practice?
I mean, we took it perhaps differently. I mean, I was a young kid at the time. I wasn't so much upset about it, because at that time we were proud and happy to have won a major competition against a major lineup, and we've been in the mode and mood, from my perspective, of generating new ideas. We were in the business of idea projection, of publishing and discussing new ways of designing. And for Zaha was a much harder shock, because she was much more ready to start building. And this is the second loss of a major project. We had 2-3 years earlier, we had a major project in Düsseldorf where we had a proper client, a proper lined up, we won a competition. And that fell through because that corporation, folded or broke up before the building happened. So this was the second big opportunity, and it was very, very hurtful for Zaha. And it was a setback in particular because she felt at the time that this was directed against her from a parochial perspective. I think there were an underlying politics actually which got in the way as well, where the sponsor of Lord Krakauer of that competition and of the Millennium Fund for this was somebody who had made himself very unpopular in Wales. So she felt there was political processes an undercurrent there which she had no power over and no dealings with. So she was very upset about this, and felt that she was unwelcome, that the project was misunderstood, etc.
This was around the time of the Iraq War as well, wasn't it?
Yes, you're right. That's one of the first Iraq
War. The mother of all opera houses was the headline. The mother of all battles was the headline.
It was very frustrating. I'm not sure of this.
You were younger then.
I was also less attributing it, taking it personally. I think she took it very personally. I'm not sure if she was right doing this. But.
Okay. I just wanted, just as an aside, this slide, just taking a look at a couple of images, stylistically, formalistically. Yeah. You have this one, you have this one. I was just wondering, is there something in this? Is this just an accident of images? Is there something about this kind of forward-looking prow that you have going in many of these buildings? Am I being flippant?
No, I think there is something about, we're always interested in long span structures and cantilevers and something, there's an element of heroism. You know, you find that in some optimism, heroism, high performance, just showing capability and strength. There is a little bit of muscle flexing there. And it lifts the spirit. I think for me, I feel like this when you see a long span, that's this power of lifting up a volume. There's this idea of an anti-gravitation, conquering gravity. There's some kind of thrill of showing human potency and power.
So it's a penis reference. Let's move on. Right.
Perhaps.
Just graphically, I mean, this is very early Zaha's work. This is the Vitra again, which is kind of, as you pointed out, straight lines and, you know, the drama of those. And then you move on to this more kind of flowing concept. Is this you? Your influence? What's happened in the interim?
It's actually, it's been in her DNA of quite a long time, but we drew it out more and we pushed it more, and we had more, that was done computational techniques, developing it more, but we also did this by hand. But if you have complex double curved surfaces and at play and make everything fluid and curvilinear, we discovered that it makes it easier to maintain legibility in the face of complexity. If you have complex and independent in many forms, you can track them better than just, they're all kind of like splinters interpenetrating. You get more traction and more elegance and beauty maintained in the face of complexity. That's why we moved towards curves. But it's been actually in the early 80s, she's invested in curvature, in particular curvature, which was her thing, which was continuously changing radii. And she made this incredible move of the rapid hand movement, when it speeds and turns and pulls and kind of ripples across the page, generates a lot of rhythm, a lot of coherency through the physics of that move, which you can give logic, order, and poise to a drawing, and rather than, and that's very unique, one of her unique moves, rather than translating all curves into arcs, which become very static. And nobody has done that before. Even somebody like a modernist Niemeyer, who started to work with curves, all the curves are rationalized into arcs in the end, or maybe sometimes a paraboloid. But so that's a new level of the freedom and versatility in the repertoire, which okay. we cherish.
Okay, I mean, I'm not really going to raise in my questions about parametrics, because we wouldn't be able to stop you. But maybe there will be questions from the audience. I'm just going to look at a couple of, as I say, topics which have blighted Zaha.
I mean, it's tough for me because I'm used to developing ideas. Instead, I have to kind of make snap comments now. Exactly. But I'll try.
Exactly. So look, so take a look at this. This is
developing
this
a thought
project in Baku. This is you. This is your answering for 30 years of work. Mm. This is Baku, and Zaha's been very determined in not apologizing for things which other people feel kind of maybe, you know, they distance themselves from. So at a time when lots of people in the West were saying we're not going to work in Libya at the time of the Arab Spring and all the rest of it, we're not going to work for totalitarian regimes. Here you are in Azerbaijan doing these kind of grand projects. So again, do I have another clip? Yeah, I mean, not necessarily that China is comparable or whatever.
Well, but to be honest, people have been talking about, he was one of them. Yeah. There were others who said you shouldn't work in China because it's not a democratic system, it's dictatorial. Yeah,
how do you determine your ethical stance on architecture?
Well, I mean, actually, I was encouraging and bolstering Zaha in her position to say defend going into these territories and being part of the developmental process in China, in Central Asia, in the Middle East, and it's really ludicrous and fallacious to write off all these territories. I mean, that's also dishonest, I think, from a lot of those critics who live in a globalized world and participate in the benefits of a world division of labor and consuming Chinese products all day. I mean, that needs to be reflected. And I don't know what the implications is of boycotting these regions makes no sense. So that had to be made clear. And I think when we came into these territories, And the kind of projects we're doing, we felt and feel them to be progressive. Cultural institutions, even, you know, this is a cluster of startup companies, mixed-use complexes with a new spirit of urbanity and modernity in China, but also in Azerbaijan, a cultural center which has been a beacon of development. We're bringing cultural events into a city which would otherwise be more isolated. So I think that can be defended, must be defended. And
there were many critics of going to China, architects who would never get a chance of getting a commission in China. It's very easy for them to be kind of ethical about it, maybe. But in terms of China, we have, this is your Soho project again, mm-hmm. in Beijing, and this is the copycat version in Chongqing. So this was actually completed just before your. So just so you understand, this is Zaha's designs, and this is a Chinese developer who just stole the idea and built this slightly cheaper version in another city in the middle of China. So what's your? Is this an honor for you?
I'm very relaxed about this, and for me, it is perhaps an honor and. I'm not fazed by this at all.
And it's a bloody awful building. Right?
Zaha was slightly more critical of epigons and was sometimes tempted to criticize other, and she felt to be copied X, Y, Z. And I said, "Don't do that. You know, let it happen. This is influence. You should be proud of. I mean, this is an extreme version, but of course, there is. I believe, and I think." Sheenian and also accepts, of course, that there's a movement of multiple authors and creators integrating in a network of influences where we received as much influence as we're giving influence, and that needs to be recognized. And it's never a good idea to be possessive about, okay. I think, ideas.
I flipped this image just so it fitted better. So if anybody's trying to read the Chinese, it's backwards. So in terms of this project, your Baku project again, look at it, memorize it, and then you have this one, which is Mai Yansong's project. So again, one is a, you might call a gratuitous copycat, and this is what, maybe a more respectful one, or is this a...
No, I think that's what I think. That's part. He's part of a movement which I appreciate, and you try something in different versions in different ways. We also copy ourselves, inverted commas, and we are also picking up ideas from others. This is Mai Yansong. He was a student of ours and worked within the office. And I respect his work. I mean, and we can also then see, learn from his failures if there are issues and problems. And also, so I know we're totally okay with this. I'm not into.
All right, cool, that's fine.
But a lot of architects are getting into it and getting possessive about it and starting to sue each other or threaten to sue each other. I think it's very childish.
Well, there's big discussions about copyright. There's big discussions about plagiarism.
Which I don't believe in, by the way. I'm even critical of intellectual property rights.
Good. What about students copying
essays? No, we promote open source, totally open source between students, and not this kind of holding back. And the problem is oftentimes...
What about students copying essays?
Copying essays?
Yeah.
I mean...
Okay, fine line.
It's maybe going too far, but I think there's a strange obsession about plagiarism, which is becoming kind of vindictive and problematic.
I tend to agree. Right, this project, Port House in Antwerp, I just read here, Owen Hatherley described it as a gigantic phallic insect mounting and seemingly raping a neoclassical building. I don't suppose that was in your brief, but what about contextualism? What about, you know, how do you see this building? I mean, how did you come up with this building? But how do you see this building in a context which many people may not see it as being the best contextual?
Well, I mean, that's one of the many examples where we show that we can integrate our buildings with historical fabrics. And you can criticize the way we've done it here. We've done it in Rome. We've done it in Hyde Park. We've done it in many other places. And but I think there is, of course, it's an unusual condition. This is the harbor. And right behind it, you have massive landscape of industrial sheds, cranes, ships. So we, not to totally disappear in this context, we created this gesture. And what is interesting about it, it's on axis. It announces the harbor. It's also the offices are pushed up rather next to it. It's great for the harbor authorities. That's where the harbor authority sits. They can see and overview finally the territory they're in charge of. And the harbor at the very end, looking at the harbor, is the chief of the harbor authority sitting. But also what you should remember is that if you go back to the other image, there was originally was a tower was designed on this building, the original 19th century design, early 20th century execution. They had a central tower marking the harbor building. So they wanted an announcement, and that would have been just a pure symbol and signal. So we, in the place of this, and there's actually an elevator going up precisely where the tower was, in the shaft of the tower, which was never built. So there is an element of contextual affiliation, meaningfulness with the spirit of that building, and also the idea of creating that courtyard underneath. Anyway, so I think it's not an arbitrary violation. We feel that it's a synthesis of sorts.
Very good.
Which makes sense.
I thought it was.
And so that's what the client themselves thought. So in architecture is articulating the purposes of institutions, which usually select the architect in a competitive process. The harbor authority thought that this would represent their institution and purposes best.
So you thought about it for a long time.
It's thoughtful.
That's what I thought. No, you have to see it. Otherwise, it's not a good gag. Right. So, just very quickly, Riverside Museum. It's interesting. The elevation is possibly the, or actually the aerial view of the roof is the most striking thing in terms of architectural magazines' reflection on this. And in terms of the plan, it's kind of there's a It's a very interesting.
I don't like this elevator, this particular view.
Well, maybe that's why I chose.
You should actually, but this is a glass wall, and when the museum is on, you can see into it very, very strongly, and you have these kind of converging and pulling lines, it pulls you in that perspective.
But I suppose my question is a bit kind of architecturally wondering what you see as the relationship between elevations and plan, how you actually develop your project.
Well, I mean, again, I feel this is it's embeds itself on that side and this promontory pushing into the water. The idea here is actually this is the zigzagging is railway shed. It's a transport museum, so there's affiliation to purposes. And then this kind of S-shaped move gives an interesting but easy navigable trajectory and movement through a space where you don't have everything in one view, so you have a bit of a, but then you can never get lost either. And at the end, that big window, the final exhibit is a ship outside here in the water. So it's conceived in the dramaturgy of the museum. It's also you the one elevation to begin with is lower, and it rises up to that moment of arrival with the big ship in the frame. So I think it's, and then the attempt, all the auxiliary spaces are tucked into the flesh of the building, like Porsche, like traditional buildings, to focus totally on that major space and shape that, and everything else is kind of tucked away. And at the front, there's another, the cafeteria and some other spaces. So I think it's that's the way you order the elements into a clear, purposeful diagram and experience, which focuses on the essential experience and movement and display. So I think that's the way this makes sense. And if you go there, the experience is very well structured and clear, I think.
Okay. I think my only point was to try and say, and you could say this about many buildings, but we're talking.
This is a bit cartoon-like. This the particular elevation.
I know, but here, the idea that you know that building and that plan, you'd be very hard pushed to get second guess that plan.
You experience as a three-dimensional object.
True. So just very quickly, just to round up. So this is Maxi. I'm just going to flick through these so we can have a brief chat. So here you have kind of one of the most emblematic buildings of Rome at the moment, of the contemporary period. You've done opera houses in China. You've done ski resorts. You've done small local health centers. And then we're now moving into Beijing, the biggest airport terminal in the world being built. We won't talk about Tokyo. And then, you know, you kind of do a range of stuff. Yes? So are you specialists in all of them, or are you masters of none, or are you, how does this come about?
Well, actually, this is something where I believe that, and Zaha believed, and so did actually the masters of the Bauhaus, the founders of modern architecture, which we still see as our the refoundation of the field. We still feel ourselves to be part of that lineage, which starts with people like Mies van der Rohe and Walter Gropius, Le Corbusier, and on and on. And they had the same spirit of addressing urbanism, architecture, interiors, furniture, product, textiles. It was all in the Bauhaus. It was all within their oeuvres. And that's the way we address. The built environment is a totality with all these elements, and these specialisms are slightly artificial, yet, yes, to some extent, there's a drive and push to ever more specialization, but when you're at the forefront, at the frontier of innovation, you need to think these things together and think them through as a unified system of creating a built environment. And for me, all design is now affected by a new spirit of what I call, you know, communication design and design all the built environment, as well as fashion, the objects through which we surround ourselves, are for me an interface of communication, structuring and premising human and social interaction, ordering social processes. So all of this participates. So all of this needs to be within my ambit and compass of an intellectual leader of the field and of a creative leader of the field, and then. Downstream, within a less ambitious, let's say, project, you can maybe specialize and do hospitals and so on. But then you're not a leader of the discipline. Then you're executing based on premises which you take for granted and apply them to particular situations. So I'm more ambitious than that.
Okay.
But I don't denigrate those which do the hard work on the ground in specialized situations.
Okay. I'm just finishing. This is the last image when, just after she died, a really very nice, respectful gesture on one of the building sites, putting up this poster. Okay. I have a million and one other questions, but I'm not going to ask them. Can we have a round of applause for Patrick, please?
This was tough. This was tough. Yeah. Kind of breathing down my neck. Come to the conclusion.
Right, ladies and gentlemen, any comments on what you've seen or your own views and thoughts? So we can take questions, contributions, as you will.
I think everything you showed is, for me, kind of fantastic in its kind of ambition, creativity, and, you know, stark contrast in terms of what we have right now in many different forms. However, there's a great kind of cultural trend, especially in design, which is all about experience. So, you know, walking across a bridge, using your iPhone, you know, making a cup of tea. The objective to a lot of design these days is also about creating experiences. It just occurs to me, from everything I've seen so far of what you've done, it could also be sort of, you know, lumped in the same sort of category, that your architecture is all about creating these sort of emotional experiences. So, you know, which is all well and good, but does that sort of become a bit too much when actually, you know, we also need to be kind of, you know, getting value out of things in different ways, that I don't need to go into a building and have some kind of emotional experience every time I open the front door. So doesn't what you do somewhat kind of play into that sort of very emotionalism sort of way of looking at life at the moment we sort of find ourselves in? Aren't you playing up too much to that kind of experience or sort of way of understanding the world rather than being more, you know, utilitarian perhaps, or more practical?
Thanks for the question. I think you make me reflect. We've sometimes reflected about this. It's a very valid question, and I think it's a bit double. I don't think we would like to and should turn every moment of an urban texture into an experience. That just wouldn't work. You would go crazy, you know. And I also don't want us to be only responsible for those special moments, which should also exist. You know, moments of being uplifted, moments where you kind of jerked out of your everyday routine and you want to be stimulated by an event, but maybe the surrounding also speak to this. So it is partly a factor of that working at the frontier of innovation with spaces and ways of articulating and creating space, which I want to downstream to be much more, become more routine and generalized, and then they would lose their experiential specialness, their conspicuity. It's a bit like Mies van der Rohe's Seagram's building when it first appeared in the 50s in New York. It was starkly contrasting a kind of shock of otherness and the new, but he meant it to be the generic. And it became the generic. And to some extent, that's partially what I also aspire to and what we aspire to. Maybe Zaha less so. But she also was into generalizing an approach. And then within that, there will be moments of special stimulation. I don't think we can totally dismiss it. And maybe that our lives become, on average, more less routinized. And more charged, but I agree with you. It can't be everything. That would be self-defeating.
So, two quick questions, if I may. Could you talk a little bit about the tension that I'm assuming exists between your desire to create something imaginative and the practicalities of the engineering to make the damn thing stand up? And secondly, I'm not from an architectural world at all. Secondly, I'm actually here as an emissary on behalf of my daughter, who's very young and interested in architecture, but unfortunately rather ill at the moment. What are the things I could say to her that actually are the downside of pursuing an architectural career? I'm sure you're very hot on the things to do with the upside, but I'm interested in both sides of the equation.
But obviously you're not keen on your daughter's choice, is that right?
She's tucked up in bed. We'll pass on that.
No, we're not talking about that, right.
You mentioned the term DNA, as in Zaha's DNA, and yeah. I wanted to ask about the future of the practice and specifically Zaha's legacy, which is in the title of this talk, because, I mean, her death, which I've felt as a huge loss, has drawn out, you know, there's been a lot of discussion about her personal characteristics and her approach, and a lot of her architecture has been located within herself, you know, as a person. And I think there's a lot of truth to that. I mean, I found her an fantastically inspiring person, and I feel that we should all take something from that, her, you know, her bravery and commitment to what she did and all of that stuff. But how, in terms of the broader mission of what she was about and how you worked with her, how are you going to take that forward? I mean, what's the implication or the legacy that we can all take from what the practice has done, and how will you carry that forward? Because if it is a manifesto, then I want to know, you know, how do we keep, reinventing architecture, and what's going to be the kind of criteria for that?
Well, first of all, I have a question on functionality of a building. Do you actually think Barbican is, as an architecture, it is functional? Because I've been living here I lived here for 2.5 years. I still get lost in these building blocks. So then my question would be, the kind of the invention of architecture could be not functional, but people start to get adopt to the kind of the inconvenience of this. So following, I will have the same comment on Maxi Museum in Rome. I was there, and the first time I went through the building, I was horribly lost. But then if you go through, if you walk this in the museum again, you start to appreciate the kind of the design of the design intelligence of the building. So yeah, so then the question it will be if you design something radically new, how important is the building to be functional, like in terms of circulation? And then like fact is we would never register a building which you just so easy to find a toilet, right? We would probably, it's the inverse. You will remember a building you can't find a toilet. That's my comment on this. So my other comment on this, Austin's copy for the Chinese architecture. As a Chinese, I don't feel proud of this, and I certainly don't promote this, but it's not a good thing. But then if you look at the kind of the construction of all these local architects without international consultant to achieve this double curvature building, is something quite, I would say, quite impressive. And yeah, so then go back to the Antwerp building. The comment from Oliver saying it's something gigantic sitting on top of the old harbor house, right? But then it's actually not the Zaha Hadid architect's fault to give the brief, right? The brief is already like this. So if you check the other computation entries, it's exactly the same thing. And I would say the Zaha building is actually the best off of all the computation entries. So the question would be, what's the power of architects then?
Well, thanks for the questions. Engineering the imaginative ideas and the way we've been evolving the work is together with engineering capacities, and actually looking towards engineers to deliver interesting and forward-looking and unusual forms with us. Because if we look at long-span structures, we looked a lot at tensile structures and shell structures or skeletons, which become structures which become expressive in the building. So we actually don't want to imagine something outside of the constraints of structural logics and then force engineers to kind of deal with this and do the best with it. We have a different process. We're looking at structural and material logics in nature, in contemporary structure engineering, which is much more versatile and in inverted commas imaginative, and develop forms which are congenial with structural logics. And that gives a new physiognomy because there's a new computational and fabrical capacity to be more optimized with these structures. So I don't see the contradiction, I'm seeing this congeniality, and that's the way we would like to push the work forward. So if you go to, you just showed the image, for instance, of the serpentine Sackler gallery, which is these kind of elegant curves and a kind of a strong, seemingly sculptural silhouette in the building. These forms are optimized tensile forms, and the structure is a minimal and lightweight structure. And you use the curvature to make that very, very thin surface span long distances, right? So that's the kind of spirit in which we work. What is negative about architecture? I'm not so sure if I can. I think architecture is like, I think all fields in the world, in the division of labor, are equally stimulating once you get yourself into it, and you have, and I think there's, one can develop ambitions and intellectual interests in all these fields, even if the field, for instance, like architecture, might initially seem technical or relatively banal compared to other conditions. I think it's something which I find very stimulating because all social processes depend on built forms, and I think we can innovate it and make a contribution to the progress of society. That's the positive. I don't want to see a negative. Initially, what I felt, if there is still a semi-negative, is that if your daughter is very ambitious and intellectually clued in, there is, the discipline is still a little bit a backwater in terms of intellectual. sophistication. Right, but that's what I'm struggling with, to push forward. And I think, but I would still welcome somebody to come in and help that, overcome that backwardness and lack of sophistication. So that was one. And Vicky, I think you put your finger on something which I'm struggling with, or which you have the perception of this oeuvre being attributed to personality. And of course, there's always a personality behind it, just in terms of the sheer energy and willpower one needs to bring to making a mark. And that you find in all great figures of architecture. But the particulars of the contribution can't be attributed to personality. The particulars of what we've developed is what succeeds and what makes sense in conditions, on social processes, of an urban concentration, of the need for more complexity, the technological capacities and opportunities which open up. There's a lot of factors which shape the work, and only because we had that willpower and intelligence and intuitions to allow these things shape the work did we become successful. And that's something we did together. I mean, Zaha is the founder of the firm, and is been a great original, and I've been, you know, she made major moves, but these moves, that they succeeded anyway, can't be attributed to that person. It makes no sense to look for femininity, to look for Arab, to look for influences. That's one kind of way of looking at things. I think it's not leading much. We have to look at what makes ideas flourish, proliferate, and cut it. And that can't be attributed to her. So and that's what we keep doing. And we develop it an organization of 400 people with many other creatives who felt the compelled and interested in what she created. And they are very, very different personalities. We all radically other personalities. I'm very, very extremely different personality from Zaha. And we had a lot of personality clashes. So it can't be, and I'm as much an author of this works than she is. So how does that square up? So I think it's totally fallacious. It's something which you find in art history. It's been discredited there too. The attempt to attribute artistic creations to personalities and have an interpretive or hermeneutic which goes into the particulars of somebody's upbringing. Or
I think that's suitably...
Suitably clear, okay.
No. Actually, suitably an issue that other people might disagree with you. So
okay,
that one
I have to one,
I see,
one
I
more.
I eyebrows was, rising, that's why.
Just the last question. There was some interesting leads there in terms of the Barbican, Maxi, and I do believe that one of the key tasks of compositional work. Let's say the architect comes in and composes spaces and arrangements and is not so much in charge of the technical functionality, which we have to be congenial to engineering logics. But what we are all about is ordering and composing and articulating spaces of interaction and channeling social processes, which become ever more complex, right? So the Barbican is a complex site and so is Maxi, with a complex institution with many parts of many spaces, which come together in a site. And yes, maybe the Barbican is doing less well than Maxi, I would argue, in terms of making that complexity legible. So the orientation, navigation, what you're pointing to, is an absolute critical element of the architect's task in to make the complexity of the social processes navigable so that we don't get lost and that we can actually participate elegantly and easy and intuitively navigate and find each other and gather and move from one moment of interaction to another. That's what architecture is all about. And we have Zaha had very, very strong intuitive capacity to bring it forward through dynamism, curvature, pose, and posture of a building in a context, which I think is announces itself and makes itself known and navigable. And I'm intellectually reflecting this and making that a key project.
Okay. So, right.
That's the power of architecture.
That is the power of architecture. That's why your daughter should become an architect. Right.
Do you want to say it very quick?
The buildings we've seen are iconic buildings and they've been pictured in isolation. We haven't seen anything around them. How would you approach designing an urban extension or new town with lots of buildings all...
Yeah, we've done that actually. We've
Hold on.
Sorry. Yeah, okay. Yeah, no, we're collecting the first question.
Yeah, you sir.
It's exactly the same point, really. I wanted to encourage you to speak more about the kind of logic of applying Zaha's methodology and your practice's methodology to master planning and to the developments of cities and city regions. And just to say that, you know, what prompted me to ask that is there is a beautiful image really early, I think, in Zaha's work in which she imagines London in a graphic, and it's as if the city on the east side has kind of melted and it's been pulled outwards. And it's mostly black, but then there's these beautiful sort of lights that sort of cut across in kind of angular ways across the image, and you know it's almost as exciting as when the Beatles stopped using the 12-bar form. You know, it's you know that something radically different is going on, and it runs ahead of the policy discussion. So I just wanted you to say something about that, exactly the same points about thinking at a different scale beyond the building.
Cool, thank you very much.
Yeah, I wanted to come back to the China-Azerbaijan thing, and obviously the criticism then was that you worked in countries which had politically unacceptable regimes. But it seems to me that that sort of line of thinking's developed a bit over the past year, 18 months or so. So a lot of the thing just now seems to be that architects want to present their work as political work. So it's not just a criticism of working in the wrong political countries, but that architecture is explicitly political. And I wondered how you respond to that, because obviously you're quite well known for your political views. So are you drawn to that sort of presentation, or do you think that it's actually more useful to defend architecture in its own terms, as it were?
You were very generous in relation to other architects, and my experience is that other architects have not been as generous in relation to Zaha's work, although they maybe weren't as articulate about it after her death as they were before. In fact, it's probably the one area of architecture where I've come across serious venom and vitriol exercised by architects against her work. And I tried to make sense of that, and I think it's stupid to say that's because she was a woman, which some people say. And I think it's something to do with that question of control and the way that you articulated your attitude towards copyright, which was quite dismissive. I'm sympathetic to that, but I think that we operate in Britain in a culture in which control, particularly of the construction process, not just of the formal experimentation is out the window. Control of the construction process and procurement seems to be the way in which we define architecture now. And I'm just wondering whether you have any thoughts on that. Is that why you and she provoked quite such the reaction within the profession in Britain?
I wanted to know what are your criteria at the moment for looking for work? What do you look for in a job? Is there any kind of work that you wouldn't do on principle? And is there anything architectural design-wise that you haven't done yet that you would like to do in future?
I would like to go back also to the political sphere of architecture, but I'll just keep short. I'd like to hear your thoughts on like social aspects of architecture. Does architecture has a duty concerning like social issues? Where do you stand?
Okay, let me just maybe this time I go the other way, inverse back. So first of all, in terms of, well, maybe the easiest one is, yes, I think the architecture, in terms of my understanding of my role as a leader of the field, I want to address all aspects of the built environment, all architectural programs, and test the relevancy of the new set of principles of parametricism, the new ethos of, for instance, always contextualizing, always making spaces inter-aware and connect building tissues rather than objects. These kind of principles apply. I want to see how they apply to all aspects. So I'm interested in all programs, large, small, medium size, and not only architecture, but as I said, also furniture and fashion. So I'm willing to take on everything, and we nearly have addressed everything already. And yes, in terms of architecture and its social tasks, I'm reflecting that. What's the societal function of architecture? First of all, we need to ask, what's the built environment doing for society? And I think what I don't want to do is focusing on architecture as social work for the disenfranchised and the poor. That seems to be when we're looking at architecture's social role, to be the focus, and I think that's false. What, at least certainly somebody who wants to look at the discipline as a whole, the contribution globally, what the built environment is doing to social processes and to the development and progress of society and world society, that's what I'm looking at. And what's then the architectural discipline, because there are many other players in the built environment. There's infrastructure planning, there's engineering, there's energy, there's architectural design, the articulation of spaces, so that's what is, when I talk about the societal mission and task of architecture, it doesn't mean that I'm focusing on, let's say, marginal groups and how to help them, because I don't think that can be done in particular through an architectural intervention, because there's so many other factors for this. I'm looking more at, rather than helping particular group, what's architecture contribution to an overall societal process, which where other subsystems of society, like the economy, the political system, the sciences, the educational systems, they all come together in generating progressive movement of architecture forward. And that brings me to this idea of when architects come forward and present their works as political interventions and forms of activism, I'm hesitant with respect to this, and because I think that we need to distinguish that for political activism, there is a sphere of politics in which this is best put forward and discussed and debated with other figures and protagonists who are debating politically. And what I find sometimes distracting and problematic that architects amongst themselves get lost in political debates and discussions and want to see their work as political manifestos, they should try out these arguments in political debates with real political players, or become real political players by joining a party, by joining a movement, by joining, rather than as qua architect, it makes no sense to be political. You won't be political. Whether something becomes political depends on political actors and not on what you self-ascribe. And I think it's a kind of vacuous posture, nearly. So that's. But we had the question of urbanism and generating something beyond the object. Yes, a lot of our projects at the moment they have become conspicuous against their context, but we embed nevertheless our work in context. We're interested in participating and creating urban textures. We also are very happy of making larger interventions, because this stopped for a while in the 80s and 90s. There was a little of this, and then in the developing world started again, the kind of satellite cities, large city extensions, large sites, and we jumped on this. We have things to say about it. We developed a research program at the AA Parametric Urbanism, and we are urbanists and like to be see ourselves as urbanists, and Zaha always had the ambition to be an urbanist. It's again what comes out of the legacy of modernism, where you actually had city building and urbanism in the work of Le Corbusier, of Hilbersheimer, the foundation of Brasilia. This is all in Zaha's lineage. It wasn't for quite a while on the agenda, came back on the agenda, and we went onto it with a lot of fervor. And this East London project is one of many examples where we wanted to see how would an urban texture evolve. It is different from modernism, which is tabula rasa, imposition of a grid, and irrespective, it is highly contextual. So we're looking, even if there's not much existing building, there's oftentimes attaching to existing structures. We look at topography, at rivers, as anything which helps us differentiating and making local and particular an urban development, to give identity and character locally, regionally. We're into this, yet at the same time we don't do that by affiliating to cultural cliches, but by developing a new identity in the 21st century identity for a particular place. And I think there's that contextual spirit of fitting in, embedding, and generating, participating in something larger than the actual architectural intervention is an a priori, not only of Zaha Hadid architects, of parametricism, but even beyond. That is something which is now an a priori of the field, which makes the contemporary, all contemporary architecture in a sense, different from the modernists, which were more about an isolated, from scratch development.
Thank you very much indeed. Can we have a round of applause, please?